what was going on then is going on now. There is no liberty in sin. There's only slavery. Liberty, freedom, is found in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Someone says, well, how come I'm forbidden to do this? Why should I not do this? I need to do this every night. I like doing it. Well, you like doing it? You need to do it? And you think you're free? No, you're enslaved to it. Because if it's no big deal, then why not quit it, right? Well, I don't want to quit it. No, you can't quit it because you're enslaved to it. And it doesn't have to be sex. It can be anything. But anything that's sinful. Got to have it. No, real freedom is found in Jesus Christ. When you become born again, when you put your faith in Jesus Christ, then you realize, I don't have to live my life influenced by those things anymore. I've got a whole new purpose, a whole new meaning, a whole new reality here to live for the Lord and to serve Him and to walk with Him and be led and guided by His Spirit, not by my base flesh desires. What am I going to eat? Where are we going to party? What am I going to drink? How am I going to be entertained? How am I going to find myself some physical pleasures? We don't have to live that way anymore. That's the higher plane. That's where we separate from those brute beasts. Those animals, and by the way, the animals he's describing there, they're not like, you know, the domesticated animals that, you know, you can actually get some purpose for as man. No, their only purpose is to capture them and destroy them if they get in your life, right? Like a bear or a lion or something like that. How does a bear wake up? What am I going to eat today? How am I going to procreate? That's the only thought. Lions, those animals. And man is not to live that way. And certainly not to live that way and call it Christianity. Now, these false teachers we see as we conclude this chapter are indicted by the Lord. Verse 20, for if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. For it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. But it has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to his own vomit, and a pig having washed to her wallowing in the mire, in the mud. They are indicted. They await that judgment when they will appear before God once and for all, and they will be sentenced to hell. These false teachers are not saved. But the question comes, in light of these verses, were they ever saved? Because recognize, if this is all we had, forget all the other teachings of the New Testament, if we were focused just on this section, a strong argument could certainly be made that these guys were once believers. Because especially verse 20, they have escaped the pollutions of the world. By the way, this is referring to the false teachers. Don't think this is referring to the guys that they're influencing, the young Christians. No. This is still the false teachers. If they've escaped the pollutions of the world, that is almost word for word, not just in English, but also in Greek, with how Peter began this letter talking to the Christians. He said, you who have escaped the corruption that is in the world. So, you know, you look at that and you say, yeah, they were. But at the same time, you look at the ending of it about the dog and the pig, and remember, I mean, we think of a dog, we think of the household pet, man's best friend, right? We think of the pig, we think of Charlotte's Web and Green Acres and Babe and, you know, Winnie the Pooh's friend and all these kind of things. Pigs were despised in this culture, especially, of course, by the Jew, right? They're forbidden. And dogs, these are the you know, scavenger, these wild dogs. You know, they're not the household pets in the same mindset that we have for them. So these are insults. Calling them dogs and pigs is insults. And if you read that, it says, yeah, it looks like they never stopped being a dog or a pig, huh? They had some sort of surface change. You know, the pig got cleaned up, but then right back to the mud eventually. And so an argument could be made on that side. No, these guys were never real believers. They never became sheep, right? And so people argue in the debate, and they butt heads over it. Now, the rest of it, of course, is inconclusive on that issue. The Bible's very clear that there are levels of punishment in hell, and we are judged based on our accountability for what we know. So all of that saying, hey, it would have been better for you not to have known the truth than to start teaching the junk that you were teaching. That, you know, you can understand that. There are some teachings in the Bible, now to expand it, because we always want to interpret Scripture with Scripture, dealing with false teachers. 1 John has an interesting passage where it talks about the false teachers. John says, they went out from us, but they were not of us. They weren't really, you know, part of the body of Christ. They went out from us, and that became manifest that they weren't really of us. That's a powerful verse about the false teachers never really being saved. But of course, I'm going to give you the counter argument. They say, well, but these guys didn't go out from them. They're a part of it. They're sitting there in the love feast with them. Okay? What about the book of Jude? Last week I made mention, and I urged you to read the one chapter book of Jude, because there's many similarities between 2 Peter and Jude, because Jude was dealing with the same false teachers. And if you read the description, Peter's description, Jude's description, you'll find it's the same sort of guys encouraging that lasciviousness and lewdness and their all of that. Even some of the Old Testament references in Jude are found in 2 Peter as well. And Jude, talking about these false teachers, specifically says they do not have the Spirit. Now that shows that they're unbelievers, because you have to have the Spirit of God to be a believer. If anyone does not have the Spirit, he is not one of his. That is just absolutely without debate. Counterpoint, well, yeah, they don't have the Spirit now. We're not saying they're not saved now, but they once were saved. See, and the Spirit left them. Aha. Well, now we can draw it a little bit tighter. Because if you have to take it to that level, now you're going against Scripture definitively. And I want us to close by looking at Ephesians chapter 1. You see, you can't take it to that level. Ephesians chapter 1. And as a reminder, last Wednesday night we talked about the Holy Spirit, especially the relationship with the Holy Spirit in the church compared to the Holy Spirit during the Old Testament. And another reason why, I urge you, if you can't make it out Wednesday nights, try to listen to the message somehow. Go online, get a CD or whatever, because we can only cover so much theology in 30 minutes on a Sunday, and we get an hour on Wednesday to add to it. And we did talk about some important things, and just can't repeat it all now, but a quick summary. The relationship between the Spirit and God's people was different under the Old Testament versus the church. So you can't look at what happened in Saul's life, for example, where the Spirit came and the Spirit left. You can't look at King David praying, Lord, please don't take your Spirit from me, and somehow think that that applies to the church, because it's not. It's a different dispensation. It's very important to keep that in mind.